much information about costs from 28 school districts throughout Wisconsin replied, and so ones that did give me the specific cost per student amount. Some, of course, do not have a student amount because they are held within the district. That was in the first part, and then I don't know if you want to talk about that first and then go on to the next.
Sure.
Okay. So I guess typically it looks like most school districts offer between about $500 to $3,000 as a rate for their partner districts or their partner sites.
When you talk with the local daycares and agencies that we're going to partner with, did they feel that, you know, like $3,000 would be enough to get going, or, I mean?
Well, I, later in the notes, I put that I'm setting up individual meetings with them, so, so those will be scheduled in the next couple of weeks. So we haven't had that specific discussion with each one.
Do you know what Burlington's going to be giving theirs that they're partnering with?
I believe that was on the information that we got from Burlington when they rolled that out. But I do not have that information right here. Anybody does? I think it's in my last one here. Yeah, in my house.
So right now, we should be getting roughly $7,200 per student?
Yes, of course, there's that fade-in process.
Right. Okay. So the first year.
Mm-hmm.
Just wanted to make sure that if we look at 3,000, that'd be enough to, you know, cover the starter costs, then want families to go there, and those things regarding that, if we need to go to, you know, like 3,200 or something like that.
Well, typically, in talking to other school districts, if they're, you know, first in doing their enrollment, then they find out, and then some have given startup costs. Most often, it's purchasing materials and sending them over there, you know, so the startup costs of the curriculum and some of those pieces could be items that we could purchase beyond the per student amount. So the per student amount per year is more so for, you know, costs for salary and for their small items that they're using, you know. So it's not necessarily including all the startup costs, but you can determine how you did that.
Motion that we set it at 3,000.
I think 3,000 is a good number. The thing I find strange on here is one of the highest ones is Washington Caldwell, who currently is running extreme problems with cash flow in their district. They have one of the highest payments, so kind of strange they do that. But the question I have is, are we on the transportation section of this yet, or is that the next?
Not yet.
I'll hold that question in 2 seconds.
Thank you.
All right.
Okay. All right, transportation.
So in talking with Rob from the bus company, I tried to get as much of the information, as well as I added one other question on here of what you had asked about. How much would it cost for busing 4K students separately? You can see it's quite a bit of an amount. I also asked him, did he know of any school districts that were busing 4K students separately? And the only one that he could think of was Salem Central with Scotia, and he said that's also because they have so many buses at one site, 22 buses, so they have one bus that just goes around for 4K, and that is, they do bus K-8 together, so that might also be a reason there. What is the cost if we could use a smaller bus? He said, well, certainly if he had to add buses, he wouldn't mind purchasing a smaller bus. But he said what you have to keep in mind is that you really have to look at the ridership in the different areas before you can determine that you automatically can have a smaller bus, because otherwise you might need two small buses and then you're doubling the cost. So I did ask him how many 4K students typically ride the bus, because I thought that would help us. Typically 50 to 75% ride midday because it's door-to-door service. But morning and night varies greatly, particularly depending if they have any neighborhood kids or siblings who are riding the bus. and depending what mom and dad's work schedule, of course. Rob just wanted to mention that, because we talked about the 310 Smile service, he said at the midday, he would still recommend that we do door-to-door because there aren't other children over at that time. And I said I think that was my understanding of what he wanted. What is the cost for just 4K midday transportation? Right now we do that with the preschool, so it's $70. For the 4K drop-off and pickup, it would be approximately $120 to $140, depending on the area covered and the timing of the routes. So he's looking for the information from our upcoming registration to really get a better idea. But if you're talking about the midday, you're talking about that $75,600 from the information that he gave me. And then what is the cost if we could use smaller buses? Depending upon, it could be a slight of a smaller charge, but depending upon enrollment, so that comes back around there.
Your question?
Yeah, well, the first question is, what are you basing the first bus, first page on? Many students?
The 220, just the bus moving and from.
How many students?
Oh, how many students? We didn't base that on how many students. He just, I mean, because there's no way to do that at this point yet. He said, if I'm running a route in Trailside, I'm running a route in Evergreen, and I'm running a route in Newfield, this would be the best estimate I could have without knowing.
How many students are we guessing? In a third or fourth gate system?
I would say close to 100.
Okay.
The population density right now is more so Woodfield. And as you know, we've more sections of care in there than we have in the other buildings. The least dense populated elementary school is Trailside right now. So, you know, it might be more heavily weighted right now just based on our care and representing that we feel that we get Trailside.
Well, not in favor of door to door service. The issue is having one generalized area of what's in your child of 4K, right now it's going to cost us almost $1,200 based on these estimates here per student in the bus. So, keep that in mind because we don't bus anybody else door to door per. So, I mean, I think the 0.3 mile is a pretty good distance. Less than that, actually going door to door seems a little bit overshot.
But I think the point is that midday they give you only one variety.
Are we choosing midday or are they choosing midday?
There's a morning section.
Are we choosing the morning or afternoon or
you should choose where they go according to the bus and according to which spots we need to fill for enrollment. We'll take their first choice, second choice, third choice, but then with what we have to fill classrooms. We should work with all those constraints to set up who goes when and where.
Okay, so try to maximize bus riders in the morning and say, minimize it in the afternoon, maybe in the morning, too, in the morning. Maybe set it up. But I just keep it in mind that obviously I'm in favor of the shorter distance, but I don't know if I'm in favor of 100% more or more, but I'm going to optimize it. Or me, that's best right now.
I like the idea of running a 4K bus. Mm-hmm. I am processed.
That was my question, too.
Yeah, I was surprised.
Because you're putting 4-year-olds on the bus with 12-year-olds, it's kind of.
Although typically, we can require those 4K students to sit in the front unless they're sitting with a brother or sister. And so it really hasn't been a problem overall.
And I don't think that's uncommon, right?
Right, that's pretty common. Because I talked to quite a few districts, and they have to sit the first few seats of the bus.
Just a question quick on the on the timeline. So we're talking about registration December, so we won't get the numbers till January?
Well, do we want to go to WASP first, and then we're going to get to the timeline? That's a good question, and I have some updates for you.
So we'll watch transportation to get the numbers in.
Okay.
Okay. All right, Rob, on there.
As far as the WASP part, I had the chance to connect with Tracy from Today's Child. Okay. Feel free to interject because I don't want to misrepresent. Okay. Anything that we talked about. And Tracy reached out to the other WASP providers at Trailside and Woodfield. And pretty much there is a little bit of a hesitation right now for the WASP programs as they are to take on the 4K kids. I guess this is the licensing aspect.
Would that change your headcount then first if you went to 4K?
Yeah, it changes our ratios from 17-1 for 5 girls to 13-1,
yep.
Which would increase our costs, and then eventually that would have to be passed on to parents, so it may not eventually be very cost effective for parents. One other concern with that, if you don't mind me saying, with licensing is that I am right now at 50. If we go over 50, it requires us to have another director at a higher level. I am at that level. I can have over 50 children with the daycare that I have, but because it's at a separate location, I have to have two directors at my level, which would really, so I would have to limit the amount of the older kids that I would be able to take on potentially. So I don't want to limit my current parents that I have already. That was not a concern.
And that pretty much reflects the summary paragraph that I put in.
Sure. Sorry.
No, it did fine. That's fine. That was the feedback from the WASP group.
And I think that'll be really important for families to have when they get their first, second, and third choice, knowing that there wouldn't be them before or after school care. That may even have their choices for her.
Or is it something with the 4Ks and then go back over to a different location?
They'd have to go back to the daycare now.
Right? I mean, could you? I mean, then take the 4Ks from here and transport them back over to the daycare location. So that should increase any cost there.
As long as the area.
Right. But we also, if we're part of the 4K program, the wraparound care students would actually, that would cost you hardly any unless they were costing two bucks or something.
Right.
But yeah. A lot of wraparound care, the parents might not care for wraparound care, so that would actually save our costs in that way.
Timeline. You have an updated timeline here, but I did meet on Friday with the principal's secretaries, the three elementary principal's secretaries, just because they work so much with the 5K registration, so I thought they could help make sure I've got all the ducks in line for the 4K registration. So they were very, very helpful. And Jen Blue also, who's going to help with the transition to 4K, was there. And so we tentatively came up with November 18th and 19th, a Tuesday and a Wednesday from 1 to 7, that we're going to have the registration. And so we'll be doing some planning because we want to have some displays and some people there and have very detailed information, and we'll get information out. But that was the decision that was made Friday afternoon, unless you have any thoughts on that.
So then we would get the results in December?
Right. Should be able to bring it to you at the December.
Is there a challenge about ready to say I have a survey? Because right now we're supposed to shoot from the hip. We don't know what the numbers are yet. It's
right.
Kind of like we're planning things without the numbers. So.
Yeah, I'd really like to have it as soon as possible.
Going to be having something when they come in for the teacher conferences?
Right. Well, PR, you know, we have a whole PR plan that Jen Lou and I are working on. So signs of information. So that information.
Thank you for getting all this information and then only action that it would be the fee for student. All right, next up is the 15-16 school calendar.
All right, based on your committee's input and then the conversation with the area administrators, the draft of the calendar for 15-16 is in your packets. And basically it's a very, very similar template to what we've done in the past, starting September 1st. Ending June 3rd. Easter break or spring break would be starting on Good Friday, and then the kids would come back to school along with teachers on April 4th. Parent conferences scheduled is the same. I mean, it's pretty consistent with what we've done in the past historically.
Chris, the only thing I noticed in May, there was not a holiday noted for Memorial Day. And I didn't know if that made a difference in your count.
Okay, we'll go back and help. Yeah, thanks for catching that. Yeah, you will.
Also move, except for feedback on the Memorial Day.
All right, we'll be back. Shirley, thanks for catching that.
Was that duty?
That is there.
I mean, obviously it's there, but it's
right, Joe.
Or did you count it, but not?
What I would do is recommend that we go for 179 days, because we have more than enough time. I know a couple of the other districts are looking at 179, so be transparent to feel about that. So.
And I like the fact that we're staying to the first week of June.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Those few days, I would see going further and further in June.
So is that clear to everyone then? If indeed the Memorial Day.
We'll just.
Okay.
Sounds good.
All right.
All right. Building safety follow up.
At the conclusion of our meeting in September, Valerie had handed, I believe, all of you a packet. I know she handed me a packet, following up from her conversation and concerns going back into August. And so I want to make sure you had that. The second piece is you had asked us to reach out to a couple of neighboring school districts. We surveyed, we contacted between 5 and 10, then we got response to 3 or 4 as far as what they do related to that, and that was included in your packets as far as the responses you got. And pretty much it was the committee now as far as what you want to do. If I recall correctly, and you can redirect me if I'm missing something here, the conversation was that we want to change our practice as far as what we were doing previously. The immediate piece here at Evergreens, we did install the doorbell system right here on the cafeteria door, so that that can lock down or secure the cafeteria for the daycare piece.
I did it, stop at the trail side the other day at 5 to 7, the doors were locked. And that was twice I stopped there. I did have somebody actually stop there the other evening at 4:30 and the doors were wide open.
Okay.
So, you know, we've got this policy, they've got the toggles to get in, then we need to, you know, adhere to it. The other thing is the parents have to realize that if somebody's coming in behind them, they don't know them. Don't open the door open for them. Which I've seen, oh, hi, here, let me get the door for you. No, if they don't have one, they don't get in. You know, I don't agree with having the buildings open all the time for security. If somebody wants to get in or somehow, yeah, they're going to get in, unfortunately. But we need to make it as secure as we can. If we stick with that, that's no problem. It's just that we can't have the doors just open and after hours. You know, like I said, I was surprised. I walked up to a trailside, had a nice note there. You had to use your thing to get in. Great. Tried the door. A couple days later, just for, you know, I stopped again and saying it was great. Like I said, I had a relative stop in the evening, 4:30 in the evening. He walked right into the building. Nobody even asked him what he was doing.
Yeah. Was the door locked?
No. Sometimes they had something going on and they just left it open, but there was nobody in the hallways that he was ran into. So.
I guess there is a reason to have the building open due to different activities, and I like the idea that, you know, children can be really experienced. At the bus and I go bad, though, they pay for the box, you know, so maybe you can check me and how often that happens in comparison to the cost of the parents unless they aren't able to do something.
I would like to thank the lady, too, that handed us the paperwork to read. It was interesting.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we had a lot of discussions that I'll bring up at Use Trailside. If somebody wanted to pick somebody up, all they have to do is stop on Kramer Road with a rifle, and they could take anybody out they want to. The building could be as secure as they can. Walking in or walking out for recess, you're free targets, unfortunately. I'm always open for more suggestions. It was, you know, like I said, that's why I stopped and checked the buildings a little bit. We have a policy, it's just that we have to adhere to it.
I know, you know, the parent thing, you know, a few times when the door, and it's like locked for Girl Scouts, and we haven't been able to get in. And then another parent that has let us in, you know, but they don't always know me for that. We can't always find the custodian when we go through there, but typically they're very good about coming.
Do they have a number posted where, let's say, the door is locked and they need to, you know, for Girl Scouts or something, they could get a hold of someone? Because right now, and I came for a board meeting one time, I'm getting a buzzer, and there's nobody around.
Well, I'm sure they have it at the school. I mean, what I want to see is I want to see the buildings maximized for the public use, that's what I want to see. The other thing to keep in mind, too, is there's federal laws on restricted use for Girl Scouts and Boy Scouts. So if they're let in, that's fine, but if you get here and they're not let in, that's a problem. So we need to have access. Now, I can look up, my camera is not by my phone. I'm sure my house, I'm sure that we can put a camera on the front door and have a number to call and somebody can get a buzzer release over the internet and phone it to open the door. So we don't necessarily have to have a hard line to somebody if they don't have to be sitting in the room. The world's a technology, don't we?
I just went one step further away. But yeah.
Put a eyeball camera out there and put a quick release door or have a high school and just have that at least.
That's a good idea. So then if I was a parent of a child and someone comes up to me, I'd be like, no, you actually need to call that number to be let in. Sorry, but that's the procedure.
Just so I'm clear,
okay.
What is the policy that I'm moving forward? Just because evergreen was the big question mark, right? It's always open, and so what are we moving forward with? I know you said there's a door going on here.
8:15 opens up to 8:10, and then it closes. And then in the afternoon, it's open from
45.
Just that we have that policy so that you can know what's the same. So if it's not in writing, maybe we should do it in writing. That's okay.
So then we can put a plaque on the front that has some phone number for building access to these phones.
Locked,
wasn't it? 3:45.
Okay. Wasn't it open when we walked in the bank?
That was because we were having our meeting.
Okay.
Right. And
so
it'll
be open for...
This
yes.
Could be
okay.
Locked then.
Right.
Those situations.
It could be open for...
Well, unfortunately,
well, we didn't. Well, no, so I'm just trying to clarify.
Yeah.
Exactly what we're all saying.
Yeah.
So it's basically the same as it was then.
But our meeting happens at 6, and the students, the class, it's done at 6.
Yeah, well, I'm saying is, so the building's open.
Right.
So.
For me, the greatest concern is when we have students in the building. I mean, I know someone could come in and hide out, but unfortunately, that could happen in any location, the library, church.
Yeah, so what you're saying, during school times, or right directly right after we have students in the building, associated with the school time, they could want some sort of, that's what we're really looking for. Right. And I'm saying after that time, I want it to be open as easy as possible with somebody calling up and saying, hey, you know, I'm supposed to be on this open.
Right.
Makes sense.
Well, I guess the question is what time is that? Because WASP is in the buildings until 6.
Okay, 6 sounds like a good time.
Okay.
I mean, before that, so let's say you have a again, being at 4:30 or something.
Right.
So what's the route that we need to take?
Typically, the den leader should have a 5.
And we don't get them first class.
Okay.
Typically, they'll watch for us, and they're very good about it. And then, for example, we use kindergarten classes, so that's the next door there. And we just put someone at the door, someone each got one.
They
let one of us in, and then we watch the door the rest of the time.
Yeah, as long as you've got some kind of plan to take care of it. Mm-hmm. Other than that, I think I wouldn't really rely on getting you're going to have to go to the front door all the time and something ring because they may be all the way across the door.
But they say that they get a schedule so they know.
Yeah. It's the ones that come in 5 or 10 minutes late.
And that's what Venus used those rooms, so then they can just poke their head by the window when we know it's 1 or something. Versus coming to me.
Okay. So the time breaks also. we want it back up. Problem right now, there's nothing in front of any door that says all this number get access.
Right.
You know, the doorbell thing kind of works, but sometimes it doesn't others.
Daycare has that, I'm sure. I mean, from 6 in the morning to 6, I mean, they have that at the door that if you need access and don't have your fob, they have that posted.
Posted.
Daycare does.
Yeah.
Flag etiquette.
I was trying to think of the lady's name, Joan.
Joan Beck, yes.
Joan Beck. And was to work with sixth grade at each of the elementary schools on a regular basis near Veterans Day so that those are the students who actually are working with the flag throughout the year. So, and you can kind of see them kind of wrestle with that sometimes and the secretaries help out and whatever. So that'd be a natural place for it to be embedded into what we do, and that way every student will get it every year. So just to give you an update on that.
Every sixth?
Every sixth grader. Mm-hmm. So as they move through the system that way.
And Joan's working?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
She's working with all the elementary principals to set up.
Very good.
Yeah. Get flyers ordered and do all those things.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.